Welcome to the second module of the Reverse Engineering Lab, which I'm teaching this semester at TU Darmstadt. In this second module, you will learn how to use Ghidra and Frida, which are both tools that are open source and meant for reverse engineering. Ghidra is something that can be used for static reverse engineering, and Frida is a tool for dynamic reverse engineering. Both of them run on many, many platforms, so it's very likely that they will just work out of the box for your target binary. So this time we will get very technical and I will tell you about reverse engineering basics. Probably not just like very basics, but stuff that gets you started very fast. So first of all, I guess you all know how to forward engineer. So you write program code, you compile it, for example, with GCC over here, and then this hello world is just translated into a binary that you can execute. Now we can look into this binary. Here it's with Ghidra, and on the left hand side you can see some bytecodes, so E8, F3, something something, so that's just a hexadecimal representation of the binary. And all of these bytes actually mean some instructions, and these instructions are executed on your machine, and because they are mapped to certain assembly instructions, you can also disassemble them. That's now the thing that you can see in the middle. You will still see the same binary instruction next to it, so that you can like see if maybe the disassembler just missed something in here. And then most reverse engineering tools also have a decompiler, which then translates this one step further back. So this now looks very, very similar to the initial source code that I wrote. So what you can see here is Ghidra, but there is more tools. So for example, in Binary Ninja, we have the very same representation. So usually that's not the default view in those tools. But again, like on the left-hand side, there is the binary, then the disassembly, and also the decompiler. And now the same in IDA Pro, but this one is the free version. So not all programs can be analyzed with this. But you can see again, you have a binary view, a disassembler view, and a decompiler view. And all of them look somewhat similar. It, of course, now depends. I mean, I just took a very simple hello world example. But yeah, that's like how it works. Now, the issue is you don't trust your compiler, or you shouldn't trust your compiler always. They make optimizations. Like, maybe something is wrong. But you really, really, really never ever should trust your decompiler. Like, it's even worse. So in compilation, what happens? Well, you have like this binary on the left-hand side, and then you have a lot of invisible steps that will produce the hex output on the right-hand side. So you can maybe see the magic bytes ELF on the top, and then there's a lot of things in there that are just like pure magic and like years of engineering to build a compiler. So they map or include external libraries, they apply optimizations. So if you write slow code, they might just replace it with something different. And they will also strip unnecessary information. Like the more information that is in there that you don't really need, that would just mean you load the binary for longer, it gets larger. So you will just try to minimize the binary and also remove function names in many cases. So even if you don't have like any obfuscation, so if there's nothing that prevents you from reverse engineering a binary, there is still a lot of information that will be missing that was in the original source code. So the first step is usually a disassembler. So the disassembler knows or guesses the address the code is loaded to, and that's already information that, like, for example, raw binaries of firmware, they just don't have this. So maybe you need to know like where the binary would be located and executed in memory. And it also knows or guesses the entry point of the binary, so like the main function. And it might also guess the entry points of the remaining functions. So you have multiple functions in the binary. Now the question is like, how do you find them? So you could follow from the entry point, from the main function, which then like calls a put s or whatsoever. And then you know like there is also a function because a call is always to a function. Or you could also, instead of like recursively trying to find this, you could also just look through the whole binary and scan for functions. So for example, if something starts like with binary instructions that are typically assembly instructions for like that, yeah, typical for a function start, then you know like there might be a function and you can like try to disassemble there. And this is not as easy as it sounds, so it's very hard to know like where does a function start and where does it end. For some architectures it's easy, and for some it is not. That really depends on the assembly language, and so especially for ARM, there is so many instructions that basically any random byte, no matter which value, is like almost all of them are like valid instructions. And this means it's very, very hard to differentiate between data and code. So sometimes there's even some values like stored in between functions or like mixed somewhere. So you don't really know like there's a binary, but what is code, what is data, where is an entry point? It's really, really, really hard. So what you can do for disassembling, if you want to do it like very simple, there is a tool called object dump, and this will tell you the file format and then also disassemble the functions that it finds. And again, on the right hand side, we can see we have this call to an address. It does not resolve all symbols, so it's just calling 0x1050, but that's like the call to the putters in our hello world again. So you can see this disassembler is not as nice as the graphical ones that I opened before, but still usable. So as I said, it's really, really hard to like find functions. And here are some statistics. So there's a paper about this, which is really, really interesting. So especially for ARM binaries, it's like probably 25% of function starts that might be missed. It's way better for Intel binaries, so it just depends. But if you want to know like about typical disassembler bugs, you should really read the paper, because they systemize like the whole disassembler process and also compare disassemblers and the reasons why they fail and where they fail. So despite years of research that went into disassemblers and function identification and everything, even these days, like if you give these tools like, yeah, your binary, they might fail, and you can fix some of these things. So you can manually tell your disassembler like, here's a function, here's data, this data is of this and that type and so on. But by default, things might just look very bad. Binaries, if you're not talking about like bare metal firmware or something, are usually packed into a format. So the binary format, like the ELF that we had for our Hello World, but also other formats, will tell what kind of architecture is being used, where to load this, where is certain information in the binary and so on, which libraries are loaded. Like there's a lot of things in there that are important during execution. And there's also like data segments and everything, so you will just see this. And ideally your binary is just using one of those formats, and then it's much easier to analyze them with existing tools. ELF is the most popular, especially like on Linux you have this, and you might have like the difficulties in there. So there could be script symbols, but if we look like into our Hello World, we have this main function again, and we even have way more symbols in there. So this one is just not stripped or anything. And sometimes developers also forget to strip the symbols. And in this case, it's very easy to reverse engineer. So you just load this into a disassembler or decompiler, and all the names are in there, and it reads similar to source code. Still not the same, but similar. On macOS, there's yet another format, so it's the macro format, and it's used on macOS and iOS, and you can use OAuth to dump some stuff, and OAuth is very useful because it also is aware of Objective-C and some other special things for those files, so the programming languages that they are written in. And then there is yet another common format, which is used a lot on Windows, which is the portable executable format. And there is a very, very, very detailed 8-hour walkthrough of the portable executable, like how assembly works on Intel, how IDA works, how the heap and the stack work. And you can just watch Pink Floyd recordings from Black Hoodie, and they are just, yeah, online. So if you feel like everything that I showed to you here and like assembly looks not so nice to you and you've just struggled to follow here, I can recommend to you like just use these. Then there's also a written workshop, so if you're like more person for reading things rather than watching a video, you can also use these. I haven't worked with them yet, so I don't know like the second links how good they are. I was just like skim reading them and they look also pretty nice, so that's just recommendations. If you need some help here, you need to probably invest some extra time, but there's good explanations online. Then there's even more formats for mobile applications, but they are just packing a lot of stuff into one zip file. So the iOS application, IPA, or also the Android format APK, they both are just a zip and you can unpack them. For Android, it's really easy. You can just like download an APK from an APK mirror and open it. On iOS, these are encrypted and you have to use Frida iOS dump on a jailbroken phone. I think someone was now meanwhile also hosting something online where you could download decrypted files. Probably this is like running on some M1 Mac in some basement, I don't know. But maybe you also don't want to like tell others which apps you wanted to decrypt and reverse engineer. So just use a jailbroken iPhone to decrypt and download the apps. And you can, of course, without a jailbroken iPhone, just download those apps, but you won't, it won't help you a lot. Especially for Android reversing, I can just recommend to you there's an Android app reverse engineering workshop by Maddie Stone with virtual machines and examples and so on, so you can just like use it as it is. And for mobile, there's also security testing strategies that are public. And of course, most mobile phones are based on ARM, and there is also ARM basics a lot on the internet. So you will find a lot of resources regarding mobile devices, both iOS and Android, online. But sometimes you just don't know what something is, right? You just like have a file and you don't know, maybe like something that you got from a firmware update. And what you can always do is you can either use the file command, which tells you the type of the file. So maybe it's already a known file format. And then there is also binwalk, which is very, very nice. So there's some binwalk output because this is getting much more here. And binwalk just tries to find things. So if binwalk just finds a path or a string or something, it will tell you, or an embedded XML. So there's many things that you can see here. So this might just help you. For example, you have a firmware update that's packed into one binary, and there are signatures in there. It will just tell you like there are signatures in it, and it's like the following certificate format and everything. That's really useful. And you can even use a flag to extract all the files that it found, or all like the parts into single files, so you can just analyze them separately and have them split. Now, the next part is that you also want to decompile something. So you disassemble it, but you might also want to decompile it. And well, sometimes it's like separate steps. Sometimes there's intermediate representations. So it really depends on the tool that you are using. For example, in Ghidra, I think it's just like you kind of define how an architecture works, and then you get both the disassembly and the decompilation. But for other tools, it's like separate steps run after each other with different representations. It's very similar to a disassembler because, as I said, it's often even like just in the same round of steps, and it will apply information that you would just like need to extract by hand otherwise. And of course, if you're not sure, like maybe the disassembler or decompiler did something wrong, you can just like use raw disassemblers again to compare outputs. And the decompiler will also try to write some pseudo C code for you that is more readable than disassembly. But sometimes it really, really fails there. So it should make life easier, but it's very common to have like both a disassembly and decompiler view next to each other just to check if this step went well or not. And there is like really, really weird errors that are often not like, you think like this looks like valid pseudocode, but actually there was an error. Yet another thing, so something that the decompiler tries to guess is the number of arguments being passed to functions, and also like the types of them and the return type. And you have to maybe adjust them manually. So the decompiler might just be wrong here, because like we are returning 0, which is an integer, but it just says undefined 8 here. And we are also giving probably arguments to the main function and so on. So it might just be wrong in some cases. And you can manually adjust for this. So this is pretty easy. So you really should do this so that types propagate into functions and that everything looks nice. So you can just like click here, right click on this thing and then edit function signature and just fix something that looks wrong. So yes, you can use a decompiler, at least if it's like legal for your target, but you should remember that it might really, really fool you and cost you some extra time in the end. Now I said like it's nice if you have symbols and that's easy to start reverse engineering, but there is also ways if you don't have symbols. So there are things that you can do to make the source code much more readable. So you would start without any function names, and then like, I don't know, you would say we have something that sends some buffer, receives something, I don't know. So this is like examples from a Bluetooth firmware where I didn't have symbols, and you start reconstructing like how everything could be according to, for example, a specification or I don't know what. And you might spend a lot of time doing this if you don't have a good idea about what your program is doing. Well, but it helps. If you have symbols, it's much easier. So in the end, for that particular project, we had symbols and it's really, really nice. So you have, you know, like what is the function name, what are the arguments and so on. So it really helps a lot, but you won't always have this. Now, yet another thing that helps you a lot is custom types and structures. So if you don't really know what a function does, but maybe then a function that it calls does and so on, you will know the arguments that go into certain functions and you can like name them. You can also create a custom type. So that's pretty often the case. You have like a struct that is important and holds a lot of data throughout the whole application. So you can just say, create new custom type and so on, and then create them and also like import them and so on. It takes quite some time. So sometimes I just say, no, I don't want to add types. That will like take a lot of my time. I want to reverse engineer, but I don't want to create structs and types. And no. But in the end, if you know like what data is being processed in functions, then you will also know what they are doing. And if you have a large reverse engineering project that really pays out in the end. So I have one example here. So there's an iOS kernel cache that I loaded into IDA Pro, so just like the iOS kernel and one function. And this is one that already has symbols. So without symbols, you wouldn't even see, like in the first line, there's this OS kext register with dtrace. You wouldn't see this. And also the global, like the dtrace model load or g OS boolean true and so on, they would just be numbers. The string would still be there, but it's not so much. Now the thing is that IDA by default does not know like where certain retables are, etc. And there is a plugin that can look for these things. So usually you would have to do this by hand. So if this was no information, that's somewhere in the binary. But actually for an iOS kernel cache, this is information that is still there and just not properly being applied by IDA. And after using a plugin, you can see it gets a lot more readable. You like know there is an OS kext get property for host architecture being called and so on, and also like some other stuff going on. And now on the right hand side, you will see the original source code. So you can see, of course, the original source code that is available as part of the XNU open source part. It's much more readable again, but already just applying some types will make the decompilation readable. So on the right hand side, of course, original C code, it has comments, it has even more variable names, but that's okay. Another thing that is good to know for reverse engineering is that the compiler tends to put libraries or modules just next to each other. So they are just put into the same location. They might even appear just in the same order in multiple binaries. So if you have like one with symbols, one without, that can help. And if you have source code, they might even, in this case, be in the same order. So if you find somewhere like some libraries or algorithms online and are able to match them, you can start naming some functions. So one example is from a fitness tracker firmware that I reverse engineered. It was using XTR encryption. And here you can just look for the constant being used by the encryption. You should also look for this in reverse byte order. So it starts with hex 9e, but you can just reverse the bytes and then look for something starting with hex B9. And this is something that helps you to find such encryption functions, but you can do this with other things as well. So if you are reverse engineering, for example, a Bluetooth implementation, and then you have the specification, it also has like weird or very specific numbers, and you can just try to find these in your implementation. Or in general, if I see a long weird number, I start just Googling for it. And in the end, I often find a solution. So I can start naming certain parts or modules. So for example, I can say like, here's the exterior decryption function or library, and I know everything is close to each other. Sometimes the compiler violates this, so there is like no 100% guarantee, but in most of the cases, it will just be looking like this. And then you can continue with cross-references, so you can just check if there's something using the encryption library. And for example, for the fitness tracker, it was the case that the firmware update module would, of course, decrypt the firmware update. So there's a reference to this. And then maybe there's like a Bluetooth module which offers the update as a GUT service. And then you would see another reference. So over time, with some patience, you can just find a lot of things, even in a bare metal firmware where you have no symbols. But of course, this will take time. And if you like don't have so much practice, then you don't really know where to start. So in the end, it's very easy to tell, hey, finding this decryption function like really helped me finding everything in the firmware. But you will not know in advance, and you need to develop a feeling for this or for what to look for. In some binaries, there might also be external libraries that are just somewhere on the system and then are loaded. And libraries can also be injected or overwritten. So that means you can just there are functions, but you'd like change them with another library and use your own function instead. And that also means that, for example, you could say, here's my memory allocator that is different from another one. And then you can just say, like, all mallocs are now being sanitized, and this helps you to find memory corruptions. And external libraries also export the symbol, so they have to define symbol names. And whenever there is an external library being used, this is very easy to reverse engineer because of this requirement of like exporting symbols to be called from an external application. Another thing that is useful if you don't have symbols or multiple versions is binary diffing. So as long as you have the same compiler options, then like the same source code will just like have very, very similar binaries in the end. And most binary differs just work on assembly level and not on the source code level. So that's important for them to be compared in those cases. There's also differs that take into account if you have source code and a binary. And you could now diff binaries like if you want to see if you have similarities. So you have one library with symbols and one without, and you just want to like merge them and import them and find everything that's similar. But maybe you also have dissimilarities. So you want to see like you have two binaries, you know, like both of them are like a Bluetooth daemon and there was a function to be patched, like there's a vulnerability being patched, and you want to find this one difference. So you have like versions and just want to, yeah, track your reverse engineering efforts from version to version. You want to see what has been patched. So binary diffing is a tool that you want to use. There's first of all bin diff, which like in the kernel has not been changed much, but at least it's being maintained to work on the latest version of IDA. There's also diaphora. And diaphora takes also into account if you have source code, because it does text diffing against source code. So it's important that you also have not just a disassembler, but also a decompiler. Then in Ghidra, there's a built-in versioning tool. And also there are function ID databases. So if you know that you have like source code and you can just compile it with different options from the binaries, you can make like some function IDs that can be matched for multiple binaries. So far, we were using static reverse engineering. So we have a binary and we analyze this binary with a tool like Ghidra. But you can also execute a file that's dynamic and then reverse engineer it using a tool called Frida. So in static reverse engineering, you have a compiler, it has an executable file that it produces, and then you can use the decompiler. But during execution, usually the file is loaded into RAM and the addresses might be different during each execution. That's called ASLR. And this also means you have, yeah, not just changing memory addresses, but also external libraries that are loaded, and everything is a copy in RAM, and then this copy of the program in RAM is being executed. And you can watch the program while it's running. So you can use a debugger, attach the debugger to the program and set breakpoints, look into register contents, into RAM contents. Tools for this are GDB, LLDB, and on Windows you have also WinDebug and others. So there's many tools for this. But we only want to learn and use one tool during this lab, no matter what the target architecture is. Anyway, so here's GDB. It is one example, so it runs in the virtual machine that we have for testing, and you can see the layout of the hello world. You can see if we break the main function and the putDess function, we have a breakpoint at an address where it's being loaded to. And you can also see that because of the copy in RAM, we have the main breakpoint, which is at 0x1149, but then during execution, it's suddenly at 0x00555149. So this is the address rebase and the execution in RAM. And then we have a second breakpoint at the putS function, which prints the string. We can use the debugger to run the program and to continue running after breakpoint, and we can also use the disassembler in the debugger. When we are within a breakpoint, we can also look at the registers and at the contents of the pointer, like of the first argument that is pointing to the string that we are printing. So it's pretty nice already, but it's, I think, hard to learn, and it's a bit cryptic, and it's something like you learn how to use GDB, but then there's other debuggers, it might not always work. And it's nice if we would have one tool, and there's one tool that works with probably everything that we are going to look at during this lab. It's called Frida, and it's very similar to a debugger. It can attach to any user space process. It will inject an additional library into your target process, similar to the external libraries that we just were discussing for the static reversing. And then you can actually write C or JavaScript that is being loaded into the process and modifying the process. There's a Python interface, so if you don't like programming C and JavaScript too much, you can also like extract certain things from the target application and handle most of the logic of the modification of some data in Python. And it's very nice if you have some black box testing, you have some nice Python libraries, and then interface a little bit only with the target program, depending on your skills. You can, of course, also re-implement everything in C or JavaScript, depending on what you want. And it has support for the most operating systems, so Windows, Linux, iOS, Android, macOS. You just learn to use it once, and then you can just use it everywhere. So similar to a debugger, you can, of course, modify assembly and registers, but you just write JavaScript for this, and that's the only thing that you have to learn. A typical application for Frida would be Objection. So Objection is a runtime that has many hooks already available. For example, if you want to bypass SSL certificate pinning or dump keychains, that's just all already in the Objection runtime. But if you are reverse engineering a target for security analysis, you just don't want to run everything that's already there, but you might also want to test custom things. So it's a nice thing to study to look into Objection, but please also write your own scripts and think on your own what you're doing. So here's an example for Frida on iOS. But please note that there's always these two components, a Python script and a JavaScript, that interact with each other. So that means you have always some communication between the Python part and the JavaScript part. There is ways to not have this communication, but that's the default setup on most systems. So you have a Python script that is running on your Linux, your macOS laptop, and it can interact with a JavaScript that is running within the process and that is like compiled just in time and running in a thread in the target. So in your target process, you can either send back some messages back to the Python script, or you can also have function export that you can then call from the Python script. The Python script needs to define a handler for interaction, so whenever the JavaScript sends something that it can handle this. And also, it needs to like load the script and also call functions in the target. And that's how they interact. There's some JSON serialization stuff in between. There might be USB in between if you have an iPhone attached to your laptop. So this might all slow down everything by a bit. But that's roughly how it works. And even if you use some of the Frida tools, so just the Frida command or Frida minus trace and so on, they are all a Python script that is running and then loading something into your target. If you are injecting code into a running process, that's again like somewhat similar to the debugger, but here we are doing it with library overrides, I think, from the implementation. You don't have to understand too much about how this works internally, but you should be aware that from the concept of how things are changed and loaded, in the end, you might get weird crashes or weird behavior just caused by the Frida instrumentation. So for example, Frida has to change some of the startup of programs and so on. I think it does this via Launch Daemon, correct me if I'm wrong, but I got some kernel panics with Launch Daemon involved when I was using different or wrong versions of Uncover and Check Rain or even other jailbreaks, so it's not compatible with all jailbreaks. Or it might be Odyssey, and then I got Launch Daemon crashes, I don't remember correctly, but yeah, just be prepared using incompatible things here will cause you a lot of trouble. And also, the script that you inject is then running in the target process, so if everything with the script is wrong, this might crash the whole process and not just something in Frida. So if you get a crash in the gum.js loop, that's the JavaScript thingy, then something is wrong with Frida. Also, if the crash indicates something in Frida agent, that's also a thread running just injected by Frida. The most useful tool is Frida Trace, so you don't even have to write JavaScript here, you just say Frida Trace, minus U is for USB, because I'm on an iPhone, Comcenter is like the phone in the iPhone, so it has it sends and receives SMS and also manages connections. And then I include everything, I don't know, I say here Objective-C something, but I could just choose any function name and the star wildcard is matching everything starting with Objective-C message here. And then I run Frida Trace, call something on the phone, and this is then just being all putting out all messages with this. I have an example later. The minus E includes just C and C++ exports. Minus M is useful on iOS because you have the Objective-C runtime being matched here. And minus J includes Java class names on Android. So you have solutions for both mobile operating systems that help you a lot. You can also capture program startup. So here you can start an application that is not yet running, and then you can see the initialization. That means if the program during startup is loading something from a database, from files, you don't miss this. You can also use some Python script to control this a bit better, and you shouldn't forget to resume the script, because if you forget resume, then the application will just quit after a few seconds. But that's the overall concept to capture program start. Now, once you know which functions are interesting, which you could find out with Frida Trace, for example, you can also write some Python script or then JavaScript whatsoever to interact with this. And here you can see a JavaScript example, which is taking into account, so there's IOKit, which is for drivers on iOS. You don't have to know this in detail, but here I'm attaching to one of those functions, and whenever it's being called, I can get the first argument with args of 0, and then there's args of 1, and so on. And this works independent from the architecture. It might be the case, especially if you're trying to modify registers and stuff. I had the experience that writing to args of 0 might not necessarily work. Maybe that's fixed meanwhile, I don't know, but usually then I use the this.context thing, so that's for the target architecture to also access registers, and then you can set them directly to certain values. Another useful thing is you might know, okay, this function is being called, but what has been before? And especially if it's something that does not appear with the Frida trace, because you don't know the function names before, it's very useful to get a backtrace that only works in the current thread. So if something was called asynchronously, you might not find it, but you can use the backtracer. And the backtracer can be combined with including all debug symbols. So that's the debug symbol.from address here. So in the current thread, you can get the backtrace and add all symbols from shared libraries. Here you can see one backtrace example that I captured on iOS in the Bluetooth daemon. So you see the Bluetooth daemon and the address, because this does not have a symbol, and then you see the libdispatch, which even has the function name init, and then again Bluetooth daemon. Then there is a library again, which is the Apple Converged Transport library, and this also has names. So in most things, you would even get the function names, and it becomes really, really readable what has been happening in order to call a certain function, in this case, in Bluetooth D. In the opposite direction, so you are in a function and you want to see what happens later on, there is the Frida stalker. And the Frida stalker is also like attaching to a function, and then it can see like what is being called from there on. Again, thread switches might not be supported, so you only see something until there's an kind of asynchronous call, but everything else works. So here you can also have different granularities, even basic blocks, and the basic block is something whenever there is a decision, for example, here there's an if statement and you have a true or a false condition that executes different basic blocks, that's a basic block. So as soon as there's this decision between two code paths, then this block is being executed in one piece, then there's a decision, there's the next block executed in one piece. But you can also just say I want function granularity, and the less granularity you have, the fewer load is being caused by the stalker. And this will be useful if you want to implement some fuzzing, for example, later on. And now there is also a very nice thing. So what we had were so far APIs. So I can program in JavaScript, I can program in C, but now a bridge is something that enables you to access something of the target programming language and interact with this. So on iOS, most apps are written in Objective-C. On Android, they are written in Java. And this just makes it a lot easier. So you have a wrapper to the objects within the program, and you can just access all Objective-C objects or Java classes and have a binding for these. So you don't even have to like write assembly or something, but you write JavaScript and use those wrappers. So this is very, very nice. And this can be combined with live coding. So you can like interact with a daemon, or here, so I'm attaching to the search party daemon in this example, doesn't matter that much, but I can access all the Objective-C classes being loaded. I can assign them to variables. I can allocate such objects, I can call methods on them. And that's very, very nice, because often you won't have like an API or something for the objects and classes in your target, but during runtime they are all loaded and it's very easy to interact with them and try things out and see if you can call something. And of course, like as soon as something crashes or hangs here, you might have just called something with improper argument, so be prepared for crashes just being caused by programming errors in the interaction with the target process. Usually my programming workflow is that I attach with Frida to a binary and then load a JavaScript. And as soon as you edit the JavaScript and hit the save button, it's reloaded. So Frida just notices the script has been modified and loads it again. So usually the first line of my script would be like console log, hey, I have been reloaded or something. And then you can also just use the scripting console in parallel nonetheless. So you just have these two windows, one editor and one console or Frida console open, and then everything, like all variables you defined in the JavaScript can be accessed in your Frida console, and everything that worked, like you tried out something and it worked and finally you found the correct arguments, you copy back into your script. If you also want to use Chrome developer tools, that's also nice, because they have some stuff that helps you with programming JavaScript and debugging it. You can use the Chrome developer tools, and there is a how-to linked down here where Tavis is using Frida scripting live in the Simpsons game. So he's doing fancy stuff just to instrument a game instead of playing it. Probably the hardest part to learn about Frida, and that's also like when you're getting started, not so easy, is that there are many things that are weird and there are no error messages because components might just not be able to talk to each other because of permissions or something. And it's very hard to know if something does not work because of versions, because of permissions, because of something else wrong in your setup. So the first thing that's super weird is if your Frida server and your Frida tools are incompatible, there might just not be any message at all, or a message that does not make sense. So check that these are both on the same version. And the next thing is that Frida might just quit or hang. So if you do something invalid as an operation, then the target process might just quit or only hang. So just try to print a console log thingy and then see if you reach the code. That sounds silly, but it's really something that I like to do. Printf debugging the best. And then also try to see if you can find a crash log. So for example, you might see that there was a sandbox violation or something. So you try to use a system call that is currently being blocked by the sandbox. And then of course, it's going to crash. And so you also have to check if Frida has sufficient permissions for what you are trying to accomplish. And even if Frida, so if Frida attaches to a sandbox process, then not suddenly the sandbox process can do things that it couldn't do. So just be aware of this. And just check for open and closed tickets on the Frida GitHub. It's really, really helpful. But only do this if you think like this is an issue that's unique, nobody else in this course is getting this error message or whatsoever. And otherwise, for just like, yeah, that's the first script I wrote, it doesn't load into my target, use the Telegram group. It's pretty high traffic, but you still get answers. So I'm surprised that people are really giving helpful answers there. All right, and now to the physical research device setup. So something that's important on all systems is use separate accounts. Always use separate tests account and also have a separate device or virtual machine. Always use like not something with private data together with the security research that you have, because sometimes, so even if you're not doing malware analysis, the issue is you have to disable security mechanisms on the research device. And sometimes, I mean, even if you say, I don't care, I only store cat pictures on my iPhone, okay, but you might lose those. So always have a backup, because the issue here is that in some cases, there are ways that will just wipe all the data from your phone if you did something wrong. So for example, if you broke something that violates system integrity protection and edited just one wrong file, then your phone will get into a boot loop. You will have to hard reset it, like really do some changes that will wipe the data. And also disable automated reports to vendors, because that's another thing. You find a fancy bug, you have a kernel panic, the kernel panic is being sent to Apple, and then Apple knows about this, is patching it, and then like a month later you report it along with a proof of concept, and then Apple says like, yes, thank you, we are already fixing this, we know of this issue. So it's not helpful to have it enabled for security research. And also disable automatic updates. So that's especially important on iOS, because it will break your ability to jailbreak a device. But even on Android, it might be the case that like the version changes and suddenly you have to do half of the reverse engineering again. Also for applications, disable automatic updates to prevent this. For Android, I have yet another slide set, because you can run Android in a virtual machine. This has a bunch of limitations. So I also have some iPhones and Android phones, like physical phones, to hand out here. And you should first check if Magisk is running and that the Android version is supported. You should also double check that the Android version is supported for Frida. So I'm not sure if Android 12 is already supported or not. It's usually safe to update to the latest Android release. Now, the thing is that if you report something to Google, you have to hand in a proof of concept on the most recent version. So if it is possible. So it's just a recent version will be considered for bounties and patches. And you should also disable the OEM lock before routing. And yeah, you can get a device in super weird states and also in states where you cannot recover it if you forget about the OEM lock. And then on Samsung devices, there is yet another thing. So usually it's very uncommon to use like a jailbreak or something on Android, but you would just root the device because most vendors have a way to root a device by design, but then the device will know it has been rooted. And on Samsung devices, it flips the Knox bit, and that means that you will never ever, even after unrooting the phone, be able to use the phone for payments and a few other things. So don't do this to a device that you own privately, only do this on research devices. And it also means that there are certain aspects that you cannot research on a phone with a flipped Knox bit. And now another thing for Android, why I think it's harder to research Android, is that if you root an Android device, that's pretty common. So many, many apps have root detection, and you should be prepared for complex root detection mechanisms. And yes, there is tools that allow bypasses for this, but they might not work for all applications. Now, iOS is really complicated. There is two official large jailbreaks, Checkrain and Uncover. It depends on the iPhone version. That's really hardware dependent. And then there's another thing. So depending on the iOS version, they are supported or not. So iOS 15 is, as of recording this, not supported on any of those. You have to be on iOS 14. And even there, I think it's like 14.6 or 14.8, depending on the newer versions. And like even 14.8, it works on Checkrain, but not necessarily with Uncover. It's complicated. So just never ever update your device, because you might lose it as a research device. And the total amount of phones that I have here to borrow is limited. So it might mean that you need to continue research in a different direction, or maybe there is virtual solution to use this, but really just break not your device during the lab. That would help a lot. Also, the thing is, like, you shouldn't trust the jailbreak too much. It's closed source, you don't know what it does. And then there is also a lot of external tweaks, but they might contain malware. There even have been known cases of malware in such tweaks. So just, yeah, use the standard jailbreak. Disable the sharing of OS crash logs, because otherwise you're not reporting to Apple, but you're reporting to the Uncover developers that you found a new kernel crash. Also uncool. And and disable as many like external sources as you can. And there's also a how-to that I linked down here, because then you're running SSH on a phone that's not really secure. It has a default password. And yeah, you can do a lot of things wrong. So really don't trust a jailbroken device, and don't store private data on it. Now, I also have a few MacBooks. I don't know if it's relevant or not, but so there is sudo on macOS. Some of you might have seen me just trying to use Frida quickly for an example, because I forget my iPhone, and like during the last lab when I did this live, not on the recording, obviously. And now the thing is, like, all processes are sandboxed. So even if I'm using sudo, I cannot just use Frida, and you have to disable some system security mechanisms, I think. So to the best of my knowledge, I also have been doing other stuff for research where I had to do this. And I once lost like the whole system when trying to do this, because on recent macOS versions, you have a root file system, and the root file system is read only. So you have the only possibility to modify it is if you say you make, you mount it in a snapshot, you modify it, then, and this read-only snapshot is again then being used for booting. And so you have to tell the system you can boot from this partition and so on that is modified. And yeah, so it's not nice. Just don't do this on your private MacBook. And you will also prick your system maybe, or have system-wide insecure settings, so please don't do this. Maybe use a Hackintosh, which is again different. So we once had like a Hackintosh-like setup, I think, for fuzzing, but then there's different hardware, and believe it or not, but even stuff like image parsers are hardware dependent, and you might find different bugs even in image processing on a Hackintosh or on an old iMac versus a new Mac. Now I have some practical exercises. So you will learn how to write hooks with Frida, and I hope that this is fun. So the first thing, now that's like in person, is that you should check that your Ghidra installation is running, and ideally locally, so you have like macOS, Windows, Linux, something, and then in the next step you will run Frida on Linux. The VM setup was described in the slides that I moved them to the first lecture so that you can set it up at home, but now we have an example on how to hook into rsyslog daemon and modify some of its handlers. So this is now in the following slides. So we have vagrant for a virtual machine, and we can just SSH into it by saying vagrant SSH. And what you can see, first of all, privileges. If you do a Frida PS not running as root, you will get a very different results than when you run Frida PS as root. And only a privileged user can list and attach to all processes, even on Linux. So usually this should work. There might be some anti-debugging features so that you cannot attach to a process, but let's just assume it works. When using Frida, you don't have to write all the scripts on your own. So one very simple solution is to use Frida Trace for scripting. So you go into the virtual machine's shared folder, and then you start Frida Trace. And here we do Frida Trace rsyslogd for the rsyslog daemon, and then minus capital I instead of lowercase, which just includes everything from the main module rsyslog daemon, and then you say decorate, which adds a bit more function names, like, or the library to it. And this takes then a while because it has quite some functions, and it just creates for every function with a name export that it finds a file in the underscore underscore handlers underscore underscore folder. And so on the left hand side you can see the output that it creates. You see all the threads that are running and the calls within that, so which function is calling what, and that's also indicated by the lines here. On the right-hand side, I have the folder open with the handlers, so that's the shared folder of the virtual machine. And something that you have to know is if you modify one of those JavaScript files, the modification will stay. So even if you run Frida Trace again, if it already has a handler in the underscore underscore handlers folder, then it will not be recreated. So you can just say, okay, I have the function name that I want to modify, and then make a change to this. And now it depends. So usually in the moment where you hit the save button, the change will be applied. But because we are running in a virtual machine and it's a shared virtual machine folder, it might be the case that the change is not directly applied, but you have to start Frida Trace again. So that depends, but on most targets, so if you wouldn't be using this virtual machine shared folder, it would be even easier. So here we have the script, so I just have the rdebug printf function here, and then you can just say, okay, we entered this and our arguments 1 and 0 are this and that, and then you can even say read C string, and read C string is a function that just reads onto the first null byte of a string and prints the string. So we can just log additional information, and as you can see then on the left hand side, if we restart Frida trace, or if this wouldn't be a VM shared folder, this would happen automatically. We now see that we extended the iodebug printf function over here. Now I'm going to do a brief live demo because it's always easier than following slides. Here I have my Vagrant virtual machine, and now I'm going to SSH into it. Now I'm in the virtual machine, and now I can run all the commands from the slides. So for example, I could now cd into the Vagrant folder and run the Frida trace minus I for the Irish syslog daemon. So that's the module and the minus minus decorate. This shouldn't make a difference yet because all the handlers are already decorated, but let's see. And now, what did I miss? Ah, yeah, the target, the Irish syslog D, and probably I also have to get root. But just let's see all the errors. Okay, so unable to find process with the name. So I have to do this as root. And now I just enter a Frida trace again. And now I can attach. And you can see it goes pretty fast. It already has the JavaScript handlers, and now we are already tracing. And I can also scroll back a bit and see my custom debug print. And also you can see, like, when there's a new task, then it's just using a different color, and it's pretty easy. So you can just see how things are being called here. Of course, something that can happen is that you have a target that has way more functions, so this doesn't work as well, and then you have to restrict the amount of things that you are tracing, such that the target process, which is creating all the prints and debug information, is not getting a very high load, but is continuing to run. There's another tool that's very nice, so it's called Frida Discover, and with this we can also have some analysis, like which stuff was called how often, and we can also cause log messages being logged to the Irish syslog daemon with the logger command. So you can just see which functions are called frequently, and even if they don't have names, they appear here. And this might help you, even if you don't have symbols for something, just to get an idea of what is important to a certain application. Now, as a hands-on exercise, try to hook a few other functions, print the past arguments, like the values, and find out if these are integers, pointers, pointers to what, C strings, structs, and so on. You can also look into the quick start guide of Frida, and you have the complete API reference. Note that it's sometimes a bit outdated, so double check if things work, but usually it should just work for the simple examples. And now another thing, because in this lab you are working on your own project, so please try to open the project in Ghidra, or if you're using Java, also JADX might be an option. And what I would like to have in this lab is that we share some screens of how stuff looks like and if it has been obfuscated or not, just that you all get an idea of how such things look like. And this is something that's, yeah, how should I say, it's hard to do this as a video recording. It's much better to do this live and to share the screens and to have very different applications and compare them. And during the lab, I also have laptops with IDA Pro, so that's a commercial tool that might have like better results in disassembly and decompilation, so we can also compare this. And then also try to attach to your project with Frida to see if there's anti-debugging in it, or if just attaching with Frida works. And if you have time left, try to find a logging function of your target so that you can print the target logs with Frida. That's very convenient. So often, if you even if you have debug logs being written to a file, just printing them in Frida as well helps you to see what happens while you're hooking into it with Frida. So that's just a very nice thing to do. If you don't manage to do this during this lab, please try this at home. Until next week, please prepare a presentation. So if you're in the 6 credit point module, please try to prepare a short Frida hook and like present this only one hook per person. So you just say, I have this application, this is my Frida hook, this is how it works, and that's why you hook this. So for example, you say that's the logging function, I hook this to see debug output, but maybe there's something different that you wanted to hook, like you wanted to change the location that your device thinks it is on, or the version of something, and so on. And then you can also argument why you changed this and why you hooked this for which goal. Assuming that you're in the 9 credit point module, I'm not sure if some people of you are, please prepare a short presentation about your target. And just show like how it has been programmed. So maybe you found out the programming language, maybe the frameworks it's being using, maybe some of this is open source, maybe some stuff has been obfuscated, especially the main binary might be obfuscated. And just yeah, try to compare this to analyze it and also maybe say if there's something else noteworthy that you found. And with this, that's the second module from reverse engineering lab, and there's yet to be another third module. See you soon.